The reason of this session is that recently, on the 6th of May, the European Commission published a communication on a digital single market for Europe. So I consider interesting to have a discussion today about the role of the geospatial sector, if any, within the digital single market. You will see from the presentation of the various colleagues which are the obstacles and opportunities that this communication try to address. And we think that most of these obstacles that we plan to remove in Europe are also the same obstacle that we have at the global level if we want to develop a global digital single market. For these reasons, I consider it interesting to have the discussion today, not only in the framework of what is happening in Europe in coming years, but more generic, which are the main obstacles that our sector face to have a real global business opportunities. And the organization of the session will be the following. There will be three speakers from different departments of the European Commission's. We will start with DigiConnect, that is the policy master of these communications, and we'll explain a little bit what the Commission plans to do within the digital single market. The second will be DigiEnvironment, that will explain in particular how INSPIRE fit within the digital single market initiatives. And also, I will also explain from a user perspective, so which are the benefits if the obstacle that we intend to remove will be effectively removed. The first speaker will be from the Director General of Informatics, that is responsible of the big program for the interoperability of public administration, the HISA program, and she will explain in particular the importance of interoperability and standardizations, and with some reference to the ongoing work on the geospatial domain. After this overview, about three different views from the European Commission perspective, we move to the role of national governments. We selected one of the 28 possible candidates, and we will have the perspective from on open data, public sector information, from the national point of view, from Denmark. And then we move to the industry. I agreed with Ed to have a completely different perspective, so I don't know what Ed will tell us. As usual, he has a free, completely free agenda, so he can say what is considered from the point of view of a very big company like Google. And then Mark Reichardt from the Open Geospatial Consortium will try to see Open Geospatial Consortium is grouping both more big enterprise, small enterprise. So it will be also interesting to see how we see, in particular, the role of small, medium enterprise and which are the obstacles and the opportunities that, that need to be addressed. The idea is like in the plenary session to give you the possibility after this presentation. I ask the speaker to be relatively short. They will have 10, 15 minutes. It's up to them to try to see if they can fit within the time. But all the time that they will be saved will be used for a roundtable discussion after all the presentation. So there will be not questions after each presentation, but you have the opportunity to ask questions at the end when the speaker will sit with me in the round table discussion. So I don't think that there is a need like in the plenary to collect questions by tweet, or I think that we are not so number or so. I think that just we will do something more interactive. Having said that, I will try to introduce Daniele Rizzi from DigiConnect. Daniele is now, he was working in INSPIRE for several years at the time. Then INSPIRE was designed, he was working in the Eurostat, in the statistical office of the Commission, that was one of the initial drivers of the INSPIRE initiative. Then now he's working on DigiConnect. DigiConnect is the major player as far concerned information technology in Europe, and in particular his unit is in charge of three important issues. One is the public sector information, the revision of the public sector information directive, so that is addressing the rule for sharing data between public administrations, and that the follow-on, that is the open data, in particular initiative about the open data portals. But recently, this unit is basically dealing with data economy, data value chain, and is also hosting the more important initiative in this sense, that is the Big Data Public-Private Partnership. It's a very big program, ambitious program. But so its unit is not directly involved as in chairing the digital single market, but is actively mentioned in the communication. So I will ask Daniele to introduce for you the digital single market and then to focus specifically on the work that he's doing.
Thank you very much, Alessandro, for this very nice introduction. Thank you for coming to this session. Welcome back after the very interesting plenary in the morning. I must say something before I start on this presentation, which I hope will not take more than 10, 15 minutes. I was particularly impressed here this morning by the number of occasions that different speakers used to introduce the concept of digital single market, and in a way to the fact that the spatial world has been presented as belonging to this overall framework. I have missed a few Inspire conferences in the last years. I was following them for a long period of time, as Alessandro announced, and then I have not participated in the last 3 years. And then I'll come back, and I remember that in the beginning, basically, spatial information was at the core of all discussions, and from technical and non-technical point of view. But this is the first time where I really see that geographic information is seen embedded in the more global picture of the digital economy. And this fits very well in what I'm going to say now for a few minutes. So the beginning of the story of the digital single market is one commitment that the new president of the European Commission, Juncker, took at the beginning of his mandate, or even at the beginning of his mandate when he was setting some priorities, even before the commission was set up. So based on this assumption, or this reality, actually, that in Europe we need to break down national silos in many different aspects of the digital economy, telecom regulation, copyright and data protection legislation, and so on. And in a way, I would like to quote what he is not written here, but concludes his statement, which is that enhancing the use of digital technologies and online services should become a horizontal policy, covering all sectors of the economy and of the public sector. So this is the recognition that the digital economy covers all the sectors of the economy, not only those who are directly related to ICT issues, and in a way, a subset of this component is spatial information, which belongs to the digital economy in its full size. So what is the digital single market? Basically, the idea is that we have achieved now, after a number of years of implementation of directives, a single market for goods, for the free circulation of people, citizens, and the goods, but the digital aspect still needs to be made, or still need to be refined at least. So we have this single market where we have free movement of goods, persons, services, and capital, but there are conditions which prevent the full functioning of the single market, and they come from the digital sector. So why we need it? Well, some figures. If you will take the time one day to go through the communication, which was adopted only a couple of weeks ago, and also on the accompanying staff working document, which is a thicker document of around 100 pages, which details the main points of the DSM communication with a lot of figures. Because one specific point that is important to underline is that the digital single market initiative is something which is wants to be extremely pragmatic with initiative which should take place in the next couple of years, so basically main to short term, and certainly during the mandate of the current commission, so within the next 4 years. So pragmatic, concrete, practical. We will see later on in which way, but and this is based also on a certain analysis of the situation with a lot of figures and on quantifications, which should back why we are supposed to do all this. So there are, of course, a lot of obstacles here. We will hear probably something on this, but you can still see that more than 50% of the digital market is made up by US-based companies and online services. And taking into account our specificities, only 4% of online services are cross-border, which is really almost nothing for a market like Europe. And most of the European one is still national. So why we need it? The global economy is becoming digital, is evolving every day. We have changing in the society. So we usual, as usual, we need to improve cross-border opportunities. And this is to improve the European economy. So as I said, it's very pragmatic, the plan. It tries to focus on limited number of coherent and high impact initiatives. So something which has not such a high cost, but has a lot of value. Again, some figures which I do not really need to go through. And those sectors are actually dependent on ICT sectors. Consumers are one third, but there is almost everything. And another thing that I wanted to underline here is that a limited number of, still a too much limited number of companies make use of ICT technologies. More than 40% declared last year that they do not make use of any digital service, which sounds incredible, but it's still the case. So we need, of course, to improve all this, in Europe, of course. So the digital service, the digital single market communication defines as three main priorities or pillars to achieve the digital single market, which are these three ones: a better access for consumers and businesses, advanced digital networks and innovative services, and something to enhance the digital economy. All these are component of, are made of different components. Many of them are not really technical. I mean, the reform of the copyright regime is not really something which has to do specifically with ICT, but that's important to allow a proper development. The same for the parcel delivery. We are here actually speaking of differences in costs for customers who order online something which has to be delivered. And for example, if you are in Germany, you have something delivered from Poland, costs half the price for the same good to be delivered from Germany to Poland. So this is something that it's a sort of roaming in a way. So there are a lot of things which basically are not necessarily IT related, but they are there to allow a digital economy to grow and to develop. I will concentrate so more on the third point, which is probably the most interesting here, also the most related to spatial information, which is the third pillar for enhancing the digital economy. And this has three, in a way, subsections, which are something supporting the development of a data economy, something to allow an inclusive digital economy and society skills, for example, and something on interoperability and standardization, quite obviously. Again, a few figures, if you want to detail a bit more. For big data and cloud, you can see here that digital data which are stored in cloud are today or last year only 20%, they are supposed to double in the next 5-6 years. And the use of big data by the first 100 EU manufacturer could lead to savings worth almost 500 billion euro. All these figures are backed by studies that you can find in the full document. So to enter into a bit more detail on what is contained into this third pillar of the DSM, concerning the data economy, the problems are that a fragmented market as it is today in Europe does not provide sufficient scale for cloud computing and big data. There are, for example, issues like the fact that there are still legislation in Europe which oblige the storage of data in a specific geographic location, in a country, or in a, even in an administration. And this, at least European-wide, is a problem, because this prevents the free circulation of data in a way, and there is not enough possibility to develop also economies of scale in a way. So, of course, provided that certain conditions are assured, like the privacy protection, then data should be let free to circulate among different possible providers of cloud. So this leads to an initiative which is called the Free Flow of Data Initiative to tackle unjustified barriers, as I say, and this should take place from now to 2016. Another point, quite obvious, is the necessity for more interoperability and standardization. Clearly, interoperability, and it will be developed later on in another presentation, allows for effective communication between digital components. And this is, of course, interoperability between different things. It's machine to machine, it's business to business, it's business to consumer, and so on. Interoperability made possible by standardization, but not necessarily standardization is clearly not enough for allow interoperability, so we did most. And here we are also speaking of interoperability, which is not necessarily only technical, but it can be also legal interoperability, can be having a certain assurance that the conditions for the reuse of data are made clear and evident to everybody in something which is comparable across member states, and so on. So the Commission, again, in this short term, will launch an integrated standardization plan to define key priorities for standardization. Yes. Regarding the third point, regarding skills, there is a gap in the skills needed by the market today. And so the Commission will address in the next couple of years the development, the support to the development of digital skills and the digital expertise necessary for the digital economy of the next decade. This is a long-term process, of course, because you cannot create skills in half a day, but we need to start now and create plans which will deliver as much as possible skilled workers in a time frame which is a bit longer than, of course, the short one. On the government, it's something regarding, of course, the modernization of public administration. We are talking here of cross-border interoperability to facilitate, on one hand, the interaction with citizens. On the other hand, for example, the establishment of quick marketplaces for SMEs who would like to establish their activities in other countries than their own one. And today, they are hampered with an incredible number of obstacles which very often basically prevent them to go outside their own national market. And one of the, for example, things that we could, that we want to do in order to improve this is the interoperability of the business registers, to allow our companies located in one country to be able to go quickly into another country and without the necessity of providing, again, documents over documents. And here we can, I can mention this principle, which is quite obvious maybe, but, oops. Obvious, but still very interesting, which is this one only request from public administration. So the fact that once you have provided one time a certain information to a public administration, then you should not be asked to provide it again. It should be up to the public administration to exchange data, to share them, and avoid that you ask it more than once the same thing, which is maybe one of, at least in certain countries, a common experience when you have to deal with public administration. And this together with the interoperability and the harmonization, for example, the public registers across Europe, should allow even an even more easy definition of business operations across Europe. I think the target is to have a maximum of 30 days for an SME to be able to establish operations in another country. Yes, so this will make part of a renewed e-government action plan for the years 2016 to 2020, which should be adopted before 2016. Yes. Okay, a few words on here, but we will develop, I think, more on this subject later in different presentations. This was just to quote some references to INSPIRE and to geolocation and geospatial information services, which are included in the DSM document accompanying the communication. So INSPIRE and the PSI directive are clearly recognized as already the enablers to implement a fully working digital service single market. There is also an international dimension, which is quite important, especially here. We always tend, or often tend, to talk and think in terms of 28 member states of the European Union, but we are here in an international context. It is very important, again, to think that we are not isolated here. We are talking global. The dimension is global. The digital economy is a worldwide one. So, of course, the digital single market will address with legislative and non-legislative issues the member states of the Union, but still keeping a look to what happens outside, and the barriers should also be broken in terms of what happens outside the European Union. And we have seen that also today that many other countries are very active, of course. So this will take, of course, this will take place in other kinds of instances, like the negotiations with trade agreements with other countries and so on. We need also a governance for all this to happen. We need a consultation with stakeholders, a bottom-up process. So all this will take place in a quite fast, at least for the Commission standards, but open way. So for many of the actions that are listed in DSM, there will be a first phase of the first phase of study. It will take place starting from June onwards, and then most probably a public consultation for some of them, and which could even lead in any case, in some cases, to green papers, which should ultimately confirm or not the necessity to intervene with legislation or with soft legislation or with organizational less combining binding organizational actions. Okay, so this is a sort of calendar. Everything is concentrated in 2015 and 2016. Very small to read, but you can read it maybe later. And it reminds all what I've said so far in terms of deadlines to be achieved in a short period of time, after all. How to know more? So first of all, the Commission is committed to organize events, contact with stakeholders, meetings between senior officials, with senior officials and commissioners and stakeholders on public events. There were already some events happening before the DSM was adopted, but mostly what is important here to know that there are events called Going Local, which will take place, from the 6th May onwards. Actually, some took place even before. So Going Local is an initiative which already existed before the DSM. Now DigiConnect is concentrating on the DSM, of course, to gain understanding and explain in each country what is the DSM and how to seek support. Normally it's organized together with the Commission representation in member states. There is a web page that you can consult to see the calendar. All countries are covered, and including also Norway and other countries which are associated to the European Union. One of the first events that took place in Sweden on the 8th of May, only 2 days after the adoption. So there was a DSM debate at the representation of the Commission in Stockholm, with organized by a local authority, by a local organizer, the Swedish Association of Local Authorities and Regions. Yeah, so this is the calendar that you can again see, to find on the website. So you see that from now to October, almost all countries should be covered. And here I terminate my presentation. Again, some few reference websites that you can consult in order to see and to know a bit more. I assume all this will be made available on the website, so you will click and see and know much more. So thank you for your attention for the time being, and then I will be later available for questions, of course.
The next presentation is from Hugo De Groof. I don't need to introduce him because he was the moderator of the previous session, so you know him very well. Hugo and its directorate has been involved in the drafting. We have this head of unit here sitting with us, has been involved in the drafting of the communication. So between us and also Margarita has been involved, but Hugo was really following together with his colleague since very closely, and can maybe tell something about the difficulty to introduce geospatial within the communication. I leave to you.
Thank you, Alessandro. Now, that was an invitation. I was looking at Robert, my head of unit. Didn't we have something with the World Bank as well, Robert? Okay, good. Indeed. No presentation, but an interesting story, I hope it will be. I have been known in this group as the moderator, in some cases. And I have even been called Inspire Evangelist. I have also been welcomed with expressions like, oh no. Once I had a good one where I came into the room and somebody said, oh my God, Inspire. I said, no, but you mean the God of Inspire. I said, this is going really too far. But one thing is clear. When you are a preacher and you have to preach into the desert, you need a very long life. Luckily, in this desert, which was the development of the single market communications, we were not alone. We have to thank our colleagues, Margarita, the JRC, in our perseverance. I have to remember that word to participate. Because in the beginning, the development of the initiative and President Juncker was a little bit like, let's start this at the highest political level. There is a high need. It has been addressed in several studies by the OECD. In Europe, we face considerable problems with regard to e-commerce, I insist, and all the obstacles which prevent us from reaping the wider economic benefits of this aspect of the digital single market. E-commerce. That was the main focus in the beginning. In this environment, we felt a little bit like the kid which was not invited to the birthday party. We were not invited initially. However, we said, but come on, guys, whatever you are addressing here, we have something to offer. We have been working with you over the years on this. Please recognize that when you are talking about cross-border problems, when you are talking about legal frameworks which need to be aligned across borders, we have done quite a lot with the colleagues. We have worked on interoperability. We have created, we are in the process of implementing, a spatial reference framework which has great benefit also for all commercial applications. This morning it was said when I walk around here with my iPhone, I can immediately find out what is the opinion on this or that restaurant. Well, actually, to be honest, if all this information is available also from governments, companies like Google or any others, they would be able to turn it into much more added value. Citizens would be able to turn it into much more added value. So we said, and luckily we were supported by many colleagues, when you think about the digital economy, you think about the marketplace. It's not only consumers and producers which are on the marketplace. The government has more to play than the initial role, which was outlined today, as being the procurers, as having a lot of impact on the market. Governments have another role to play. We have to make sure that all our government data, all the kind of resources we are, and can also be put to use. When I walk on the digital marketplace, the first corner I turn to is, of course, the bio corner. It's the green corner. Why? Because I work for environment. And there is an awful lot of things that we can do in terms of e-commerce in changing the behavior of consumers, in making them aware of the decisions you take in your daily life, and also enabling them to bring into this, onto this digital marketplace all the information they dispose of themselves about their property, as mentioned this morning. It's closest to the heart of people, their own property, the attributes, the characteristics of their property. But you need to be able to put that into a spatial framework. A lot has been said about volunteer geographic information in citizen science. And we know platforms such as Ushaya and others, which more and more are going to play a fundamental role in increasing the transparency and the participation of people to the governance. Again, this data needs to have somewhere a spatial reference framework so that it can be meaningfully be combined with government data. You have seen some references to INSPIRE into Daniele's slides. I tell you, getting those few words into the start working documents, it has been like a game of ping pong. So we were invited to play in the ping pong comments and track changes into these documents, and then they were ping pong back now. And we kept on insisting, and we were supported by others. Finally, we managed to get something in. Because we said that, luckily, we were supported by a number of our colleagues. We said, you have communities such like e-health, e-transport, e-this, e-that. We didn't dare to mention the environment, or otherwise we would have been looked at again as those guys with the goat-worn socks and the Birkenstock sandals. We kept our ambitions rather limited at that time. But we were very happy to see that, because this was totally ignored in the beginning. The only community in the digital single market were consumers and producers. Of course, there are many problems to address, but we are serving communities. We are serving e-health communities. We are serving e-transport communities. And all these, they have also, in their activities, an impact on the environment they can contribute to. So luckily, at a certain stage, we got a chapter also on inclusive action. We need to build up skills and competences. And luckily, we also got a chapter on e-government. We also have one on interoperability. And I recall from an early version of the document, especially in communication, it was mentioned that we should make the European interoperability framework, as a result of a strategy document, mandatory for implementation across Europe. Now, Margarida, correct me if I'm wrong. That framework has been around for something like 13 years, 12, 15 years. It's a set of principles, sound principles, exactly the same principles that we try to implement through INSPIRE. It talks about, as Daniele said, also legal aspects of interoperability, where we need to align. And we have been contributing with INSPIRE considerably, concretely, and I think the only legal instrument, which has completely contributed to this European interoperability framework over the last 10 years. Really trying to look at issues such as geo-blocking, mentioned in communication, from the aspect of e-commerce. But there's a lot of geo-blocking, as we have learned, still existing, between governments, between having to share governmental data for dealing with important societal issues, such as transboundary air pollution. Only now, some areas, we start to have real concrete sharing of air pollution monitoring data. even the real-time sharing across borders of emission data has been a big issue. We still have issues in countries where they say, well, you know, the gouging data in the from the rivers, we have to negotiate at a certain moment in time for the emergency service, which runs now at the GRC, for something like 3-4 years before countries were willing to share this gouging data across borders for setting up a flood alert system. So geoblocking does not only exist in the e-commerce. Obstacles are there. And the INSPIRE directive, like I said this morning, was the result of a consensus. It was setting out a direction. That's why it's called a directive. It's the direction. And then member states go home and they implement not only nationally but also in all their regions. They try to translate this direction into more concrete legislative tools, which then again needs to have this legal interoperability across borders. And I can tell you already now, today, that this has not yet been realized. So if we are talking about the future of the digital single market strategy, and we're talking about e-government, then we have to take initiatives, laws, such as INSPIRE and the way they have been implemented and transposed. We have to take them up to a next level. We have to be serious. We have to be, again, perseverance is important about implementing those. The interoperability issues. I had the advantage and the honor to be invited several times by organizations like OGC and others when they came together with W3C and SEN. So I must admit, I always wonder, why do they ask me to come? Because I don't know too much about that. Of course, I understand interoperability, but I'm not anymore on the topic. And they explained to me, INSPIRE is the biggest test bed in the world that we have. And it's fact that by including in our more technical pieces of legislation around INSPIRE, those standards which were tested, which were mature and so on, we can achieve a higher level of operational interoperability. And in the meantime, the same organizations, they keep on working with practitioners on the use cases, and they bring again new, more advanced standards, which again we can then say to the people, those are the ones you need to implement. So INSPIRE concretely, if we start rolling it out further and further, is a considerable, can be a considerable contribution to the EU's digital single market. But we should not stand alone. I'm standing here and I'm preaching again, and I'm preaching to the converted. I tell you, when we were sitting there, Margarita, you remember in those meetings, getting the word geospatially, that has been a major victory. I tell you, that was not easy. It was big data. Internet of Things. I said, big data, big data. I have no big data. When I was a young computer scientist, I had big data. I had to carry, first I had to carry a box of these cards with old questions. Big data was a real 720 megabyte of CCD. That was big data. It was as easy to handle as it is today. It was the same thing. It was just a matter of scale. Nothing has changed. But also in the big data at the time, when I got from my friends at the European Space Agency, the first ERS satellite imagery, radar imagery, which was my field of activity, and I got that from four different, what they call, processing and archiving facilities on a CCT, where there was a so-called SEAL standard describing where every bit and byte was on that tape, and I plugged it in. Now they were all different. Somebody had invented some kind of different profiles of the SEAL standard. Exactly the same problem 20 years ago as we still have today. So not much has changed overall. That's why it's so important that we agree between those that are implementing in the organization a minimum set of standards. But that's not sufficient. The minimum set, fine, take INSPIRE. The minimum set of standards which are being implemented for example, a spatial object, spaces, where is it, the coordinates, the box, all the other attributes of it are not in the legislation, they are called extensions of, give you an example, you have an industrial facility, great. So you have the address, you have the coordinates, you have the, what is emitted, the emissions. This is in the extensions into the guidance. So again, taking INSPIRE to the next level is that for a number of important use cases, we will have to agree on extending these data models, putting them in common registers so that the industry, the ESRIs, the hexagons, and so on, can incorporate these models and use them to lower the cost of implementation applications. And the only way we can do that is that when you the converter, and I'm looking also at my colleagues from the INSPIRE expert group and political groups which are here, get more active in influencing the e-government people in your own governments. I was looking at what I find called e-government national fishes, which are in join up. It's not a word about geospatial, there's not a word about INSPIRE. I look at the names of the people, and I wonder if you guys know them. We need to talk with them. E-government, as it was presented, and I have something like now 8 years of experience with them. Whenever we talk to them, we said, yep, it's important. No, 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 it's about invoices, it's about this, it's about that. E-government is more than that. So we need to pass that message from our community to their community. And with this, I think I'm close to my 10 minutes. And I'm going to stop my preaching. At least, yeah, I'm not going to be crucified.
Thank you, Hugo.
What is happening here? Okay.
Okay. Our next speaker is Margarida Abecasis, that is the head of unit in charge of the program for interoperability of public administration, and she can elaborate a little bit how interoperability and standardization fit very well now in the package of the digital single market.
Thanks, Alessandro. So, boa tarde, não sei se está alguém em português aqui. No Portuguese people, I cannot believe it. Well, then, good afternoon, in that case. I would like to start by making some links of the geospatial history and personal touch. I'm very pleased, particularly pleased to be here, because I don't know if you have noticed, but across the street where we have the tramway, a little bit more to the right, there is an old building falling apart. And this old building was my high school.
Wow.
And it was named after a Portuguese queen, which was Rainha Dona Amélia. And she did a lot for the education and women education in this country. And so it was the name of the high school was her name. And I spent marvelous years, of course, in high school. I had lots of fun. And we would come here to this place. It was, at the time, it was the International Foire of Lisbon, and there was a bar. And so when we didn't have classes, we would go to the bar and have fun. So I like it special here, and I was thinking about geolocalization. It would be good to have in geolocalization the story of this high school and this building, this palace, from a noble family from Portugal that is unfortunately falling apart because there's no money. But, well, that's a link to history. Is also important to put history in the geolocalization because it gives a lot of interesting information and we can learn a lot about it. I will speak a little bit also about the European Interoperability Framework and the revision, and a little bit of touch on the mandatory, not mandatory. It was also a little discussion during the Digital Single Market Initiative preparation. So my name is there, I don't need to repeat it. I will speak about digital single market, the role of interoperability and the programs in Europe, the current program that deals with interoperability between public administrations and the future program that will start from 2016. And you see, you will see a lot of things in common with the presentation this morning by Mr. Howell from the States that has working. They are working also in the same kind of problematics, and interoperability is key, and we face similar challenges, and we try to link also with what they are doing and not reinventing the wheel. So where are we? So the three priority areas that were introduced by Daniel. Interoperability is explicitly integrated in the third one, but it is behind everything, in fact. Interoperability is strategic for any area that is mentioned in the Digital Single Market Initiative, from the cybersecurity and then Internet of Things, intelligent transport systems. Everywhere you look, you have interoperability as a condition for implementation. In the particular area that we work on, which is the public sector, and the implementation of these main principles that are required for the modernization of public administrations, like once-only principle that was mentioned. It is funny, yes, once only, but it's true, it tells a lot. Open services, open data, one-stop shop, digital by default, everywhere you cannot do nothing, you can do nothing without interoperability, interconnection, information sharing, etc. So what is the state of the interoperability in Europe? It is important to see the figures, and they justify in a certain way what we want to do in the future. So this is the state of play of interoperability in the public sector in Europe today. And you see that the European Interoperability Framework was transposed in 23 countries, which is a good score for something that is not mandatory. 72% of alignment of the national interoperability frameworks and the European interoperability framework. So we can say there is a common understanding of what is behind interoperability, of its principles, the basic recommendations, on base registers, for example, or public service models. So there is a common understanding of what is needed to implement interoperability in the public sector. The problem is that when it comes to concrete implementation, the figure is a little bit different, and we come to 28%. Large differences, of course. If we go to Denmark, they are the masters with 80%. Spain, they are also very well. France, Estonia, so Italy. So there are some that are very efficient in implementing, others are not. The reasons for these differences are diverse, but I think one of the most important reasons for this lack of implementation, let's say, it's the leveraging instrument. Because when we look, for instance, into Denmark, who is the owner and the responsible for the implementation? To oversee the implementation across the administrations, it's the financial ministry. So it is easier to impose or motivate, let's say, motivate the implementation when we have some strong arguments. So there is margin to do something here to help national administrations implement interoperability. And that's why we have this action in the Digital Single Market Initiative roadmap. You have the priority ICT standard plans and extending the European interoperability framework for public services. There is a lot of debate around would it be mandatory, the transposition in the member states. There are some member states that are strongly in favor of this, of making it stronger, because it will help them afterwards implementing it nationally. The others are more less keen on this. So there is, and this was seen in the discussions in the preparation of the document on the Digital Single Market Initiative, and so in some places you will see it appears as a mandatory implementation of the European Interoperability Framework revision, and others it doesn't appear. So this is something that will certainly be the object of big discussions and, around Europe in the next months. So what is Europe doing for the interoperability between public administrations? So there are today it's the ISA program, Interoperability Solutions for Public Administrations. It's simple, the same name. And the program ends at the end of this year, and we are currently in negotiations with the Council and the Parliament for the future program, which is Interoperability Solutions for Public Administrations, adding the businesses and citizens. And like it is important, this fact that we add now citizens and business, because for us, of course, at the end of the day, this is for them. And so it is important to have them in the loop and to know what are their needs, what do they want, like Mrs. Bermania, I don't know how to pronounce, told us this morning, it is important to ask them what they need. And that's why it is there. One. The second, we cannot speak of interoperability if we don't take care of the source of the information, which are most of the case, the interoperability and citizens. And so this will be the future program. It will run from 16 until 20. It will be basically the same financial envelope. So this is not a big financial envelope to build big infrastructures. That is not our purpose. We are here to put in place, to define common specifications and join the efforts of the different areas that contribute to this interoperability. Because also, as was mentioned often this morning, what is the biggest problem that we face today? It's the silo mentality. So we consider that one of our major missions in building interoperability between public administrations is putting together the different sectors and their different contributions to the interoperability. Knowing what the others do, starting by knowing what the others do, because often it's also a question of not knowing what exists, and joining them together, put them around the table, and try to build on these different efforts. That's the interoperability puzzle that we're trying to address and put together things. And then there is the holistic approach that we think that is needed at European level, but also at the national level when building interoperability. We think of it as a city planning, where we have the supporting instruments, and in the supporting instruments you have the European Interoperability Strategy, the European Interoperability Framework, the European Interoperability Reference Architecture, the European Interoperability Cartography. And it is important, and this links with what I was speaking, which knowing what exists if we don't know what exists, how can we reuse? And how can you know that I can interoperate? So it is fundamental to have a cartography of what exists. Cartography in the sense not of a map. And sorry, I should have started by explaining this in this assembly, but in an image way. So to have a register, I call cartography, but it's a register or it's a box where you have all the identification of all the different solutions that we have, but exposed in a structured way. And the structure that we apply is the reference architecture. Because if we don't have a structure, it will be the mess that Mrs. Bermanian was mentioned this morning. The scenario is confusing. So we must put some order on that scenario, and that's the reference architecture. So besides the supporting instruments for the city planning, we have the key interoperability enablers. What we can say are the city utilities, the water, the energy, the communication cables. So you need to have these utilities in place, which we can say that make the link with data exchange, e-signature and DID, essential for interoperability, semantics, base registers, and catalog of services. And then the third, and we come to the subject of this conference, are the support to specific policies, and here we have the digital single market and INSPIRE, which we have been working with for some years from now, and the next slides mention the three areas. The first is the European Union location framework that we have been supported, and whose purpose is more to define guidelines, document reporting, give input also for the revision of the INSPIRE directive, which I think it is in pipe. And also, I think this is very important, are these pilots in the three areas that have been launched recently in the area of DG Move, DG Mari, and Energy. Because the case studies, the pilots, the real implementations, the example of implementations are fundamental for others to follow. The second action that we are supporting and closely following is the ARENA, where the purpose is to build a collaborative platform. And I think the most important achievement in this area is the registry that was mentioned by Hugo a while ago, which is fundamental. Again, registry, we need to know what exists. And of course, there is an alignment between the European Union location framework and the European interoperability framework. So the location framework follows and addresses these different views from the legal, the organizational, the semantics, and the technical views. And in the future, we will be revising the European interoperability framework. And one thing that we are discussing with our colleagues from INSPIRE is how to integrate or make the link between the two, the INSPIRE and the geolocalization, and the European interoperability framework. Because we are particularly focusing the cross-sector aspect of interoperability. Because in the same sector, we have a lot of things. The taxation guys, they have interoperability around Europe. But when it comes to cross-sector, there's nothing. And in fact, where do you gain more from interoperability? Of course, you gain in tax, you gain, so that's clear. Then home security, you have also interoperability, although the efforts can also be done. But the fact of joining different perspectives, the fact of joining information from different sectors, and geolocalization is important in there because it is everywhere. It's when you join information from different sectors, when you join information from different perspectives, that you reach the best results in terms of innovation. When you are always in your box, innovation, well, you can innovate, huh? But the biggest results, the biggest added value is when you go and look what's happening in other sectors, join with yours, and then come out with real innovation. So the cross-sector aspect is, for us, the key word. And for the cross-sector, you need the geolocalization horizontal perspective underneath, so that you can join all the information, for instance, in a given location from different, from the health, from geo, the mineral, from the climate, and you join all this information around the, and you come out with the new ideas. So this is what we think it is very important, and that's why we are addressing this, and this is our challenge for the future. So do you have the alignment of the two? And this is an invitation for you to join the Join Up platform that was mentioned by Hugo a while ago, and I will look into the fish to see if there is nothing on geolocalization there, because I didn't go through all the fish. But you can join the Join Up platform and the communities, and we'll be shortly putting in place a community on interoperability, European Interoperability Framework Revision, and I invite everyone to join us, put there your comments, your input, and work with us in this challenge that is the cross-sector interoperability that will give us the opportunity to innovation, big value added in this area. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Margarita. I think that now you have a complete picture about different perspectives of the European Commission. And now is the time to leave the floor for looking to national perspective. And Ulla, that is the chief advisor for the Danish government. She is the representative of Denmark in INSPIRE different activities, and is particularly working on the Geodata Agency. That is one of the agencies that are really a mandate. It's not a mapping agency, it's broader. And since the beginning, the agency is integrating all the data and try to make all the data collected by with a location character by the public administration accessible. But I leave to you to express the view.
Thank you, Annoni, for the floor and the kind invitation to attend this very interesting session, I'm sure. So far it has been, anyhow. My name is Ulla, and I was invited to speak a bit about open data. I guess mainly because Denmark has some experience now in open data, but also because open data is seen as this huge main key that can really open up the market. So let's have a glance at how that is going. Benefits of open data. Yeah, we have the ones that we calculated, and then we have the ones that we experienced. But what made it possible? I will tell you a bit about that. Of course, the long marriage with the e-government agenda, we have heard words about that, has been a lever, but also the way to open up the data. Then, of course, we hooked up early on the EU and the global agenda. You have to, being a small country. And then we accessed in the bumpy road between politics and strategy, and again from politics to actually use. And that's where all the difficulties really lies. Yes, and I will address that one latest. This is one of the issues that I'm digging more into right now, but more about that later. I will start with the public sector. In Denmark and in most of my colleague countries, it's an old public sector, and it is still trustworthy. This is cadastral mapping way back from 1600, where the king said, we must do that. He didn't do that for the citizen, he did that in order to taxate. That's okay. And my point, I will come back to that. But remember, old and trustworthy. Yes. In Denmark, we do have sort of an international tradition. Yeah. We tend to look outside the gates. As I said before, we are a small country. But we are also connected to the rest of Europe via land. And we just do that as a part of our being Danish. So, another thing is that we're part of the common market, the European Union, even though some are a bit skeptic, we are, and many of us find it a good idea. A lot of regulation, a lot of directives is being laid down on us as Danes, and as we now have to do it, we might as well do it well. And one thing that's important, and that is the carriage of the way we handle e-government and spatial information, let's not do it twice. We do not have the money. And that's not just because we're a small country, it's because that's the way it is for all of us. So we used all this as a political lever to get into where the money is. And as you pointed out, the Ministry of Finance is a very good dance partner. A bit demanding at times, but a good dance partner. So we used that very strategically and also very tactically, actually, in the building up and in the development, in the continued development of the NSDI and e-government. And of course, alongside was INSPIRE, the PSI directive, and the ISA. Very important tools, politically and also in the use. So yeah, up come the good old basic data program. Some of you have heard about it before. I won't give you a whole lecture. The main clue was that now spatial data was on the agenda and we went open in Denmark with a lot of our raw material, our spatial data. And my agency really became a heavy INSPIRE pusher during that time. And the Ministry of Finance does that now, actually. So free access to basic data for everyone. I should say that the municipalities and the Geodata agency actually freed all their data because it didn't make sense just to have a little pool not free and the rest free. So what happened? Well, important here is not so much the figures. The important here is the red and the blue. Because the overall business case, the overall Ministry of Finance talk was that, yeah, we start with an investment that is mainly paid by the governmental sector, and then we will see this growth in the private sector. The private sector is the red. You can see from tomorrow, 2016, we are going to see this growth in the private sector because we have the open data. So what happened? And I said, we're not in 2016, we can still be there. So we should remember that. When we let the cat out of the bag, what actually happened? It was in October, thank you, 2013, that we freed it. So what happened? We saw Google as one of the first integrating our reliable and high quality data into their maps. And we went, wow. And we saw Microsoft doing the same thing, and we went, wow, wow. And OpenStreetMap, wow, really? And we invited Mr. OpenStreetMap to our agency, and we gave him these two hard disks full of all our data, and he was a happy man. Thank you for use of the slide, Tina. So that's good, isn't it? Well, I also have the privilege of being Vice President for the Association of Geospatial Data in Denmark. It's an umbrella organization, public research and private. And we only just finished a survey among our private members. And what say they? They say that they don't believe, to their knowledge, that it had changed anything really. Well, 60% does. And they pointed out that there was problems with data quality. And that can be a lot of things that needs to be dug into. What do they mean by quality? But there's an issue. And they pointed out this about the metadata. It is not enough to have these technical information. You need information about how can I use that in my business? What are these data actually best at serving? And then, wow, the difficult topic, right? And for a governmental agency, a really difficult subject, regulation and legislation. Some of them pointed out that we need guidelines and we need to have simpler rules. Then we can always push the monkey and say, well, that's the EU. They're coming with these very, very huge directives and we can do nothing about it. Of course, we can do something in national legislation as well, but we have to work upon it in a European way. Simplify it, otherwise it is not usable. And then, of course, there's the needed cooperation. And here it's about governance again and again. And what do we mean by governance? We could mean anything from rules to actually political responsibility. Here it was more about the rules and the roles. Where does the public sector stop and where does the private sector begin? Do we have a gray area that we have not defined? And is there a lot of possibilities lying here that nobody is actually doing anything about? I think that is. And then it's about create some open networks where we can meet informally private research and government. So when you make basic data, you have to agree on a certain level, certain quality standard, and that you're paid for. So one size fits all. We know it's not true, but that is an issue that is becoming even more important as time goes on from 2013. Who is going to pay for that? In the olden days, a customer asked for a specific product and paid for that product. And don't get me wrong, I love open data, and I will never ever roll back if I had the possibility. But this issue, we need to solve this together. And another issue that this survey pointed out is that, yeah, access and services and INSPIRE is a lot about setting up these standardized and potentially interoperable services. But is that enough when you're a client? You need to shop in a governmental shop as easily as you do, as this is from IKEA. And again, thank you, Tina, for the slide. You need to do it as easily as that. And you need to customize it, because one size does not fit all. If I need a green sofa, I will not only be shown a red. It's because I do need a sofa at home, that's. Yeah. So open data benefits. Have we got a contradiction here? When we in the public sector must provide efficiency, cuts, more for less, but on the other hand, shall also provide growth in the private sector. How can we do that? Parallel, are we going in different directions? Is it unsolvable? Because how do you balance all these few standards, open source? I can't remember if there's another click. That was open source. How do we balance that? Because on one hand, we're eating the market that we are supposed to feed and make grow. And on the other hand, we need to be efficient and we need to standardize and we need to uniform things. So we have an issue here, private, public. And where does the digital single market then fit in all this talk? Well, we've just heard all during the day the geodata. We call it geodata in Denmark. I know spatial data is more, well, anyhow, we do. Spatial geodata is fundamental, absolutely. and we need an infrastructure to get the information to where it is needed. So much, so good. But we also heard several examples that it's not about technique. Did I spell that out yet? And I will quote now the INSPIRE Working Group on Digital Single Market. Said something in April. That was about something e-commerce, but it counts for spatial data as well. It absolutely does. So we really do need INSPIRE, and we do need ISA, because they deliver the frameworks that we shall grow upon. But I also think that INSPIRE, and probably also ISA, needs the digital single market. Because how can we make it important for our politician and our Minister of Finance to keep on financing these extra size and shapes? Go where the money is, and the money is in the digital single market. So I think we should severely hook up on this agenda, supporting it, but also it's a tango, it takes two. If we are going to do that, we must expand our work. And we need to remember the soft issues. We speak about expanding data models. We speak about specifications that are 700 pages long. And I am not lying. But the soft issues, the things that really makes it matter, the things that make the compromises good, and where we can say, okay, maybe it's not 100%, but it works out here, so who cares? That is only accomplished if we have a eye-to-eye level, government, public, and private. And remember the consumers, because they are the ones that matters. If they don't buy our products, we're not in business, public or private. That was my preaching. Thank you.
Thank you a lot. Ulla. And now I know that I take the risk to leave the... But I like risk, and Andy know me quite well. You have a presentation? Ulla was quite interesting presentation about what the public sector should do in the future. I don't know if you are elaborating also what the private sector is expecting to be done. I don't know if it's part of your presentation, but I will be interested to have your opinion.
Thanks, Alessandro. It's always a pleasure to follow Ulla. It's great what's been going on in Denmark. For someone that's come from the public sector, originally, it's a perfect example. But today, I'm not presenting a public sector hat, obviously. I'm going to talk about, I suppose, not just Google's view of this, but the private sector view of the digital single market. And I thought I'd draw inspiration from our actual location. I don't know how many of you have had the chance to go exploring in Lisbon, but if you go off, I think in about that direction for about a kilometer or so, you'll come across this fantastic statue of all of the great navigators, the great Portuguese explorers, Henry the Navigator and onwards. And there's this great history of exploring, of moving beyond the bounds of what's possible to create new markets, to find new opportunities somewhere beyond where we understand. And I think we have an opportunity today with the digital single market here in Europe is to all be explorers, to go beyond the limits of perhaps what we're familiar with and expand into new markets. But that's sometimes quite a scary process. It's quite a scary process to get into the boat and go sailing off across the ocean, not quite sure the destination, not quite sure what's out there. It's not necessarily going to be an easy journey to take. If we wanted to talk to someone outside the conference center about why what we're talking about is important, and I think that's a question we really should be able to answer, we only really need to show people this slide. This slide shows you the difference in unemployment rates between the United States and the Eurozone over the last five years or so. And if there was ever a need, ever a reason why we need to be looking at things like the digital single market, this is it. Because it's about people, ultimately. It's about actually making opportunities for everybody else that's outside, that looks into this Congress Center and thinks about, well, who are those weird people talking about maps and standards and interoperability? Actually, we're doing that because ultimately, if we do our jobs properly, we are going to create opportunities. And that slide should always be in the back of our minds about why we're doing this. We need to create more opportunity here in Europe. We need to do that because digital represents 13% of the global economic output. Let me just put that point across again. 13% of all economic output globally, and this comes from the OECD, is digital. It's related to the internet, it's related to digital data. And actually, in many ways, that's probably an underestimate. The digital market, the digital industry, is the engine of growth over that five-year period that we've been looking at. The reason why, in many ways, the United States has had that growth where there hasn't been in Europe is they've really adopted digital technology and they're making most of the use of the digital market that's there. Digital powers all sorts of activities. And actually, you could argue that today, if you're not a digital business, you're not likely to be a business for very long. This is not all about the startups and it's not about people creating apps, it's not about the European Google. It's about every small business in Europe adopting digital technology and making the most of the opportunities that digital technology provides. Every business is digital. And if it's not, there are going to be issues. Now, let me just show you a very short video. This is from a customer of Google, actually. They make use of Google AdWords, but it doesn't matter that it's Google. It's about a small business really making use of digital. Hopefully you'll be able to hear this. There should be subtitles.
Vintage Bailo Perinares nace por la inquietud y por la ilusión y por las ganas de luchar de tres generaciones de mujeres. Nuestra gran ilusión es fusionar la historia y la joyería, como por ejemplo las famosas joyas de Audrey Hepburn en Desayuno con Diamantes o la tiara de Sissi Emperatriz. Ahora mismo recibimos casi 1,000 visitas diarias a través de todo lo que son nuestros perfiles online y el 75% de las personas que llegan hasta la tienda llegan a través de búsquedas que han hecho en Google sobre palabras clave en las que nosotros nos hemos ido posicionando. Bueno, es cierto que las empresas grandes tienen muchos más recursos que las pequeñas, pero la ventaja que tiene Google es que nos da a todos las mismas oportunidades o las mismas herramientas para luchar y llegar a cualquier parte del mundo. Nos encantaría que las nuevas generaciones que vienen detrás nuestro pues continuaran con la saga familiar.
Okay, so there's a lady in Madrid who's following her passion. She loves jewelry, she's starting her business. That business wouldn't exist if it wasn't for the tools and the digital technology that now exist. And that's going to be increasingly the case, that we need to make use of these technologies to develop our businesses and to move forward. Anybody recognize my explorer of the day? Vasco da Gama, very good. Vasco da Gama and those explorers were, if you like, the classic entrepreneurs. They were going out to explore new opportunities, to try new things. They were the startup generation of their time. And actually, if there's a real gap in what happens in Europe, it's in support of entrepreneurs and startups. Although, yes, every business needs to become digital, if we really want to exploit the potential, we really want to create the European Google or the European Facebook, we need to support much more entrepreneurship in Europe. And that comes through training, it comes through skills, and it comes through a framework that allows people to take risks, allows people to find finance, to create venture capital opportunities in Europe, to really exploit the opportunities that might exist. Now, obviously, that development could appear in places that we're not familiar with. You know, there's the kind of archetypal geek here, someone in this case playing with Google Cardboard. There's an estimate that by 2018, the market for application developers will be worth 63 billion euros. That's 4.8 million people employed in building apps. They don't look like us. They will probably never talk to us. We will need to build mechanisms that allow them to get access to the information that we're creating, to build their apps, to build their products, and to allow them to reach the markets that will consume the products that they create. This is a huge growth opportunity, and there is a burgeoning app development market in Europe that is largely invisible, still relatively small. It is building on top of platforms that exist not at an American level, actually not at a European level, but at a global level. I'll come back to that point in a minute. But the key point is that these guys don't look like us. And they're never going to look like us. But we need to be able to support them. And to support them, we need to create a market that's at the appropriate scale. Now, I was amused by this article in Geospatial World, a magazine a month or two ago. There was a commentary on why Google had pulled out of the enterprise GIS business and saying, well, largely you pulled out because it's not a big enough market. It's millions, and actually Google's interested in billions. Well, there's an element of truth in that. There's an element of truth in that markets online have to be large for the scale of many of these new activities, new opportunities to work. For Google to work as we do, to create products based on the advertising model that we use, we do need large audiences. We do need audiences in terms of tens, hundreds of millions. So having a digital single market of 500 million people, as opposed to 28 markets of tens of millions, does actually make a real difference. But to put that in perspective, the digital single market in Europe, 500 million people or so, will be the same size as India, will be half the size of China, will be potentially the same size of Indonesia. So yes, it's important, but it gets you up one level of scale. But in terms of the way the internet works, actually, the scale of internet markets is even bigger than that. It's actually global. I'll come back to that point. Now, how many people recognize the cookie monster? Who can tell me what I'm getting at here? How many of us feel reassured by that little pop-up box that appears whenever we go to a website that says, this website uses cookies, and are you happy with that? Yes. And often there's no button. It's just, okay, I'll deal with that. I know that was done with the best will and the best intentions, but actually, guys, do we really need more regulations? Now, I know, probably, to create the digital single market, we are going to have to create new regulations, but please let's get rid of some in the process. The thing that's going to create entrepreneurs is not a list of people that they need to ask permission from. The reason the internet has grown up and has been as successful and as powerful as it is today is even today, still, you don't have to ask anyone's permission to create a website. You just go and do it. And that's where entrepreneurship, that's where the creation of new economic activity has its greatest benefit. So please, no more cookie laws. Now, actually, from a geospatial point of view, we haven't, as a large American company, struggled hugely in Europe because of regulation, to be honest. You know, during the sorts of things that we are doing, creating mapping platforms at a global scale, yes, there are lots of regulations in Europe, but it hasn't been hugely difficult or hugely complex. There are lots of steps you've had to go through. There's much more communication and more effort than ideally there should be, but largely we've not been prevented from doing too much. So in terms of geospatial, I don't think there are too many problems. That said, there are differences. And those differences are, in some case, down to local regulations, but fundamentally, sometimes they're down to cultural differences. The fact that we are still 28 different countries that think differently. And that may still cause an issue in creating a single market. The obvious example, the one you knew I was going to talk about, was Street View. Over the last decade or so, we've been trying to capture Street View across all of Europe. It's the same technology, it's the same car. Often we just change the registration plate and drive from country to country. It's the same process. But we've had to deal with 28 separate data protection agencies across Europe, each of which had taken the same process and looked at it and viewed it slightly differently and saw it as a greater or lesser extent an issue of privacy. There's an obvious gap here. You all know why that's the case. But, you know, that's Europe. That's the single market. And realistically, are all of the nations and all of the citizens across Europe going to agree on a common understanding of what privacy is? Don't know. It's going to be hard. It hasn't stopped us creating Street View. It hasn't stopped us going off and giving the citizens of Spain and France and Italy and Czech Republic and Poland and Slovakia and Hungary and Denmark and Netherlands and a few places in Germany, the potential to use Street View. But it would be nice if we could do it everywhere. Everyone would then benefit from it. So there, the difficulty, as I said, is not in concrete regulations, concrete legislation. It's more a cultural difference, I think, and an understanding of what is acceptable in some countries and not in others. And where I think we really do have to be those brave explorers going out into the world is that when you create these online markets, these online opportunities, you don't know necessarily what direction new companies are going to lead. By their very nature, disruption will occur in these new markets. You bring back potatoes from America and you suddenly create, you know, new opportunities. You bring an underlying platform of knowing where vehicles are and where potentially their customers are, and you build Uber. And Uber works really well for end users, for people that want to hire a car, but it's hugely disruptive to the current taxi companies around Europe. And they have responded in various ways. Perhaps the next real big disruption is going to be probably someone like Airbnb, where they're disrupting the rental and holiday market, where again it's connecting people that want a service from other people that can provide a service. They disintermediate. This disruption is going to come when you create a single market, where you allow people to be entrepreneurs, to see opportunities, to see markets, to see groups of customers that were previously poorly served and can be served better. But there will always be a flip side to that, where the incumbent will suffer. But that's part of the territory. You have to go along with that. If you want to protect the incumbents, let's stop wasting our time with a single market, because it's not going to happen. Finally, I've been hinting at this. Digital, the internet, is really a global market. Much of the initial development, yes, sure, has happened in the United States. Much of the economic activity that we currently see online has come from that historical growth of digital from the United States. But actually, if you look at almost every company that's successful online, they don't see themselves as serving the North American market. They don't see themselves serving the European market as it emerges as a single market. They say, I'm here to serve the globe. I'm here to serve customers wherever they might be. And okay, that might be really difficult at this point in time because there is no single global market, but we will persevere because where those companies are really successful is in focusing in on the user, saying, there's a user that has a point of pain that's not being served particularly well by the companies that currently exist. There's my opportunity. And that opportunity for most companies is global. Now, whatever we can do in Europe to make those new companies that go and attack that global market, to make them European, we should do. It's about removing regulations, about improving skills, it's about creating that European market. But the European market itself won't be enough. They have to attack that global market. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
This was a very interesting perspective, and we learned quite a lot about sorry. We learned quite a lot about what should not be done, and now I think that Mark will tell what should be done, probably. Sorry. You are already.
Good to go.
It's working?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Wake up call for everybody, too.
Okay. So I don't need to introduce Marco Reichardt. He's the president of the Open Geospatial Consortium. That is a very big consortium in, with a network of in which way?
Okay. I'll tell you what, I'll just work from right there.
Yeah. Oh, no. We do like this.
This is interoperability in action.
So then you need a US and a European Union representative. Sure.
That's right.
Okay.
Thank you, Alessandro, and thank you to all the previous speakers for basically capturing my discussion. What I want to do is to respond from the geospatial perspective, looking both at the state of standards. I won't talk about any individual standards, so you're happy to know that. And also about the representation of our consortium, which is a mix of industry, government, academia, and research working together to develop interoperability that is meaningful to the community and to the market. And I'm going to invite Ed to basically catcall when he wants, because he's a very active player in our process. Any other OGC members in the room? Oh, Ivan Deloach in the back from the U.S.? Great. So let's do this. If I misstep, just scream at me, and I'll jump up and down and correct myself. But the point is, we've already covered this ad nauseum today, and I think it's an important thing to reinforce that everything happens somewhere, but it also happens somewhen. So location and time are two concepts that we have to pick up as part of the digital single market. And it's critical to all the professional things we do from day to day, but as citizens, it's critical for us just moving around anymore. I love the picture earlier today about the when the Pope was installed back in 2003, everybody looking forward, in 2013, everybody holding up their device. My son will not take a phone call. He's all text. And he moves around campus using location apps. It's a totally different world between the generations. So this is a serious issue we need to integrate into the single market as we move forward. I am about interoperability in our consortium, but that's an example of what interoperability is not. Staircase to heaven, perhaps, but it looks like a staircase to a brick wall. But we are about interoperability and creating that smoothing of capability for ICT to be able to flow easily between applications and for data to be shared broadly across the infrastructure. You know, if I look back at what we did back in 1996 or 7 or 8, when OGC was just coming together and finding ourselves in the context of standards and the internet, I wouldn't be able to show you thousands of implementations of open standards that are actively creating interoperability, plug-and-play capability, and that's true today. Here's just a few examples, some in the US, some in India, some in Europe, of professional applications that are out there supporting aviation, global Earth observing, oceans, geology. It's just really cool to see how this is taken on and how it's implemented and how it's working fairly well across the globe. And it's based on a set of geospatial standards, standards that support the integration of sensors, standards that support the integration of processes so you can navigate around the city. And there's a lot of other stuff happening right now that's bringing in Internet of Things, and it's bringing in augmented reality and allowing us to go indoors. And all of it's standards-based. Some of it's adopted, some of it's new, some of it's tried and true. And all of this needs to be brought into that inventory as we go forward with the framework so that the market can take advantage of that and benefit. Of course, the geospatial infrastructure around the world is helping with this because it's creating an underpinning capability. Most impressed, and I agree with Hugo's comment earlier today, that INSPIRE is the poster child of a way to do it right in terms of specifying interoperability protocols, policies, and so when you look at INSPIRE, it's a way to unite the region, not only from a policy standpoint, but from core standards and data services that interoperate and lead up to a global infrastructure. And I point out that in the US and Canada and nations around the world, they've adopted common protocols, common standards, and we're seeing the UN working with the developing world to create simple messaging for them to adopt those very same standards to enable geospatial information to be liberated, shared across borders to address various issues. So that part of the story is pretty good. And we're increasingly seeing the movement toward commercial applications and location capabilities. But it's not just government that's driving interoperability, it's the market. So we have two members in the OGC that are data providers. We have Digital Globe and we have ExactEarth. Both of them are providing both information and analytic services through that very same infrastructure of open standards. So it's really cool to see that we have public sector involved in agreeing on digital standards for ICT and geospatial. We have the market now responding to that, providing data and services through those same standards. And as Ed said, we have this explosion of mobile capability, and some of them are leveraging our standards and some of them are off doing their own thing, and that's the way the market behaves. The market behaves the way they can get out quickly and make the buck or the euro and move forward and build a market. And so our challenge is to work with this environment, very new environment driven a lot by millennials, new developers, and to try to understand and anticipate and work with that community to develop the kind of standards that will respond to this market. And yes, there are a few European apps on there, Ed. But when we talk about standards, it's really an economic benefit. How many of you have seen the German DIN study? So they're talking about in 2010, over 17 billion euros of economic activity and benefit just from standardization, activating markets, creating jobs, creating capability, improving security. So that's at the standards level. If you multiply that around the world, it's pretty huge when you talk about the value and benefit of standards. And then we saw this morning a range of benefits. I think it's without question, it's obvious that geospatial underpins almost everything we do, and the value of the market is pretty significant. In addition to the dollars back to GDP, the Oxera study that Google commissioned include things like gas savings for routing, a whole bunch of different things that come with more consumer behavior than professional return on investment. And so when you add all that up, it's just a huge level of savings. And it goes on and on around the world. The value that's out there is undeniable. So I can't believe for a minute that geospatial shouldn't be underpinning and a part of the digital single market. It needs to be, it must be, and it needs to be an integrated part of the whole. Helping with this process is a developing level of policy at the organizational level, in the public sector, in the private sector, and around the world. And this is just a few examples of some of the policies that are being put in place to sort of reinforce the goodness that has been experienced in using these open standards. And I think when you look at the sum total of this policy, there are some things that can be brought forward to the digital single market to address not only the technology standards, but some of the policy barriers and cultural barriers between national governments and the national boundaries that limit interoperability. I think the technologies are there. For geospatial, the standards are there. There's more work to be done, but the core of standards are there. It's really the policies, the culture, and the legalities that need to be addressed, I think, in concert with defining those standards more broadly. Now, with that said, I think the goals of the digital single market are absolutely right on, but I come from the U.S., and when I'm in Europe, I can't interoperate with the U.S. from the market. I'm denied seeing videos, I'm denied listening to audio. I have the same issues as you do in the national boundaries here in Europe. I can't listen or access the commerce in the U.S. in many cases. So I agree with Ed, this is a global issue, and I think this is something that the DSM may become another poster child for how to do this more globally, how to structure ourselves globally to break down these barriers. Now I'm going to play a video here. This is one of our members who is not a technology provider. They are a consumer, and I'm just going to play this and I'll comment after it's over.
Insurance alone is not enough. You need to do both risk management and purchase insurance only for the part that you think you can manage.
And remember, we're insuring Fortune 1000 companies, 40% of them. We found that 80% of their losses could have been prevented.
Businesses can choose not to have damage from hurricanes. Hurricanes result in a lot of flooding. So sometimes it's localized. Sometimes, in the case of Hurricane Floyd a few years ago, it was very extensive flooding.
FM Global's clients had only $100 million in property losses. Analysts say that's a low number compared to the company's competitors.
So $200 million worth of loss in a single event may seem like a heck of a lot, but when you compare it to $22 billion lost by the same event by the industry, that's astounding. Now, in this video, the CEO of the company goes on to say that they don't do anything with actuarials. Are you familiar with actuarials? Basically, estimations of risk. They have 1,400 engineers that do the analysis when they before they write policies to make sure that chances are the event won't happen in the first place because they've done the risk mitigation. So the message here is, I don't know how they do things internally, but I do guess with 99% certainty that they're using location information in the process of assessing risk and in the process of writing policies. And there's a parallel here, I think, to the European location framework, because this is one of the four, I think, use cases that have been defined, right? So the important thing here is that this company is a multinational company. They have anchors in Europe and elsewhere. They have barriers as well as anybody else to getting information, and the more barriers they experience, I would imagine, the less the capability they have to estimate risk. So if we look at companies trying to understand risk, trying to maximize opportunity, we need to break down those barriers so that data becomes available, whether it's open data or whether it's data provided as value added by industry. There needs to be a free flow of that information so these organizations can do their jobs. Additionally, in our consortium, we have a number of small companies. You know, we're 512 members strong, and over 200 of them are from Europe. Many of them are small and medium enterprises. And 5 years ago, I can count on both hands companies that were one or two person companies. Today, they're multi-million dollar companies, and they're now multinational, multi-regional in many cases. And they've been able to generate business and generate economy based on standards. They're innovating based on standards. So there's another aspect of this that I think we need to consider is that the European economy will benefit through the implementation of standards as well. And I'll come back to that in my summary. So if we take the next step and we look at where we go now, we have all of these standards. We're really focusing right now on urban resilience. You know, how do you take and command a detailed level of information about a city, model it, bring together not only the engineered information and the geospatial information, but sensors and processes so you can understand the behavior of a city, the life cycle of a city on a minute basis or daily basis. And so we're working in building a spatial framework for smart cities. The reason I bring this up is because there are a whole bunch of economic benefits to be had, not only in the public sector for improving services and safety to citizens, but in terms of businesses, in terms of retail siting and placement and foot traffic and just a myriad of different things. And I know in Europe there's a heavy emphasis now on active aging, understanding the behavior of the aging population and how we can maximize the opportunity for the citizens. Again, having a model of a city is going to help us understand how we move forward and benefit from that and actually create an environment that's useful. Well, it might seem interesting that at a city level, perhaps that's not a DSM issue. It is. And the reason it is, and the reason I'm envious, is because when I look at Europe, you have a lot of policies in place and objectives that you want to hit, and they're pretty astounding. In the case of energy conservation, you've got some numbers in terms of conservation and efficiencies that are pretty darn dramatic. And you're doing things right now. I see programs in place to bring in solar, alternative energy, wind, but also to conserve energy as well. And if you don't have the ability to look at cities around Europe and understand as a whole how that progress is occurring or where the issues are, you're going to have a hard time meeting these goals. So from a public sector point of view, the digital single market makes sense to try to activate and address these problems. And I think it's a noble goal. It's one that I think the world needs to pattern. You know, in the Western world, we're consuming most of the energy resources as we have them available to us now. And then going back to cities, we can't do this without working with the broader standards community. We have relationships with over 40 standards and professional organizations. And for cities, we're working with two groups in particular, three groups actually, Building Smart, the World Wide Web Consortium, and ISO. We're working hand in hand with them to develop the standards to be able to do a spatial framework for smart cities. So from a digital single market point of view, it's not enough for OGC to say that we're developing standards. I think it's more for us to say that we're coordinating up and down the standards community to make sure that we're doing it right and everything's integrated from a standards perspective. So in summary, it's my position that the geospatial standards policy that I've shown you and some of the things that we're doing reinforces broad implementation of common standards to aid in easing information sharing across the ICT spectrum, reducing costs, lifecycle costs and implementation costs, and also enabling new capabilities to mobilize quickly. Avoiding ICT procurement vendor lock-in, and I know this is an issue we've all tried to avoid, is to be able to pick the technologies that you want. And then spur innovation and competitiveness. And again, we're not going to have that competition and innovation, I think, at a maximum or optimized until we can break down these barriers and have a single market. And I also point out that we've seen it time and time again that when standards are adopted, there's an ability to go beyond the European market. The international market will become appealing because many of the other nations and sectors are adopting these standards. And then a peculiarity that I find interesting, and I'll be happy to talk about it afterwards, is that from a research point of view, we're seeing standards processes like OGC being used to help move that research very quickly in the broad application using the open standard as an envelope. So we have a lot of participation in our process, not only to influence our standards, but also to use them as a mechanism to get out into the broad market very quickly after the research results have been found. So I think all of those things come together very positively for a fairly good message for standards. Are we there yet? No. I go back to the mobile market and some of the changes that are occurring in the market now. We need to work a lot harder to keep pace with the way the market's changing in terms of technology development, mobile apps, things like that. But I'll leave it open for questions after this. Thank you.
Nasty questions.
Everything would be better than sitting here.
Yeah, but no. You will say there is 5 degrees less than here. Then this is warm. This is why I'm moving here sometime, because this is warmer corner. Then you will be freeze now. Before to leave to the audience the possibility to make question, I will try to wrap up the very interesting message that I captured from the various presentations. One of the first issues is that any kind of actions that we are doing for the digital single market should be, I would say, user-driven or user-focused. If we are not involving the user, there is no way to develop new services and new businesses. So again, this is a big thing. And I think that is where I see very well the role of the private sector, because it's the private sector that is connecting with users, and we need to understand how these kind of convergences of policies can, I would say, cover both aspects from what should be done from the regulator, for the public authorities, and for the industry to support these type of things. The second point that has been raised in a way, in a contradictory way, is about less regulation, and I refer to Ed presentation, but from the other side, saying the same presentation, we heard about harmonizing the culture. So one of the problems that was in particular emerging in the Street View example, that from one side, we don't need regulation because we need to set up quickly the services. And from the other side, there is some obstacles related to the different data protection. So again, this is something that is interesting. So at which level we try to harmonize cultural things and how to do without the possibility, for example, of regulation. And we have the example of that Margarita made about this framework that have been adopted in some countries 100% or 90%, in some country not. So also this kind of cultural harmonization in the case of the ISA framework show that it's not easy to put something and to see something really implemented in all the 28 countries. Another issue that is particularly interesting is, I think that was mentioned again by Ed, is we have to look to the global market and not to the European market. So this means that we have to think about anything that we will do in the frame of the European digital single market should not be restricted to the European digital single market. So in particular, when we are looking to standards or whatever, there is still a dimension to ensure that this is not creating an additional obstacles. Another point quite interesting, that the digital single market could be a reality if there is a kind of revolution of the public sector. What means revolution of the public sector? Means that if the data of the public sector have to be used by the private sector, as mentioned in Ulla presentation, we have to ensure the quality, but we have also to ensure that the public authorities are becoming reliable partners. And reliability means that you should be sure that accessibility to the data, usability of the data is ensured, and not only the data are put somewhere open, but they are not really supporting the need of the application providers. In an area in which is not clear for me, it's not coming from the various presentations, is which are the specific measures that we need to think about to facilitate innovations. In particular, my interest will be to try to identify specific measures to facilitate innovation using the already, I would say, considerable investment that we are doing in creating spatial data infrastructures. The last on my list, and I apologize if I forgot something important, is that we are also to start thinking about the new business models and the new governance framework. Because it's clear now we are looking to partnership, we are looking to convergence. The old model don't fit for purpose, so we have to think about, was also mentioned in the Ulla presentations, we need new mechanisms in which we are ensuring that public and private sector can work together, and PPP or B2B business can be developed. So these are my conclusions, but I don't want to consume the time. I want to leave you the possibility to ask additional questions. If not, I have my long list that I will use as a backup. Do you have any question to all the speaker? Or specific question or clarification about the digital single market? It looks...
I hope we can also ask...
You have to tweet to me if you want to... Okay, I receive a tweet from Hugo, please.
There you go. Now that I'm sitting next to Ed, I have a question about the cooking monster.
Okay.
Yeah. You could imagine that. No regulation is the best regulation. Mm-hmm. Right? Now, one of the issues we are confronted with in our entire open data market, when I look at the number of data sets in the open data portal of the European Commission, or even in others, I see very little, not that many data sets sometimes. Right? There's a lot that is still withheld. And why is that? I recall last year's INSPIRE conference when, from the UK, the cadastre, there was a very convincing presentation how cadastre data was being made openly available for reuse at no cost. He said, well, we have a bit of a problem because we don't know what people do with it. There's an issue in good governance, and it's called accountability. You give it out for free and say, okay, go away and do something with it. On the one hand, that's great because already we have sunk the costs, we have recovered everything, fine, so why should you hold it? As a lot of the models at the moment are still requiring recovery before we put it out, so fine. So if we put it out before we have recovered fully the cost, in some way we must be able to trace what is being done with it and how the bigger benefits economically are reaped. And when you say from a Google site, oh, you know, we're not doing that. Then sorry, there's something I don't understand about your business model, because everybody, I'm always reading Facebook, Google, they are following you around, they are seeing what you are doing. So you are continuously making my account, right? Because you have to prove as well your accountability to somebody, to your customer. So it's not that much different. The only question I ask, if we as a government would put in certain hidden conditions in what people are doing with our data, so we could trace what they are doing with our data, and then go back to the people who provide us with the resources, right, if that would be acceptable. So it's just a reflection that I made about the cookie monster.
Well, you shouldn't believe what you read, necessarily.
That's true.
It's not always accurate. So, we don't track everything you do, clearly. You know that we don't track everything you do. So I think you do, though, have a fair point about, you know, what's the accountability of government data, and how, if you are a government agency and you want to know how your data is being used, how do you measure that? How do you do that more accurately online? It's not easy. I mean, one of the things about, you know, as soon as you put data online and you make it open and accessible, is you lose control of it. It's like mercury. It will flow in whichever direction it finds is easy to flow, and you'll end up with your information appearing in a product or a service you had no idea of. And that is just the nature of the internet. It is just the nature of the way things work. The reason that we can track adverts and we can track, how a user goes through a particular website is, as you say, things like the cookie, and it gets in the way, and it gets in the way, and it gets to the point where the commission legislates that we have to put a little banner up to say, we've got now a cookie that's tracking your business, and that gets in the way. It's the way the internet works. I haven't got an easy solution for you.
Interesting discussion. During the survey that I presented to some of for you, the private sector distinctly said, we have no problems about being locked, because we lock our own data. You have to log in. So we know who is using them. We do not know for what purpose, no. But what they said, the private sector, is we would so much like structured but informal channels to give you this feedback. They didn't speak about cookies or doing it digital. They spoke about the dialogue. Please listen to us. Take our experience into account when you next time maintain your data sets.
Yeah, you raise an interesting issue that when the private sector is using public data, there is a need to have a mechanism to have the feedback about the usability of the data to be transferred to the public sector in a structured way. Margarita, then Mark, then Daniele.
Related with the presentation from Ulla, and related with the comment from Hugo on the public sector also as what does it do with the data? How does it provide data? I would read a phrase that I discovered some time ago that is interesting. So just to put it straight, that the position is the data that the public service owns should be open data, of course. And it comes from a while ago. So we must consider that the citizens are contributing, and they are the actionaries of this great enterprise that is the state. They provide the funds. They are the masters. So they are the masters of the data that is in the possession of the public sector. Who said this? Does anyone know? Already heard
Hugo.
This? No, not Hugo. This time it's not Hugo. You're safe. And unfortunately, I don't think we can do anything about it, about this guy. His name was Emmanuel Joseph Sears. And he said this in 1788.
Oh.
It was a guy from a law guy from the Revolution, the French Revolution. So it's a while ago. So you are in good company. You are in good company. But this comes to the question: is there a limit for the public sector to stop in the provision of services? Yeah, because we could just put data out there and that's all, and then to the private sector. I think the personal opinion, I would like to know yours, I think the public sector should do a little bit more than that and go and position itself as provider of service, and in this context also, of course, obtain the payback of the cost of provisioning these services. That's I'd like to hear your opinion on this.
Mark.
Yeah, just two comments. In response to open data, it's just my personal opinion that, you know, industries that succeed take risk. They take risk and they try things, they fail sometimes and they succeed. In government, we tend to be a little more cautious, right? But putting open data out there, even if you don't know what the ultimate purpose might be, sounds completely reasonable to me, because others will likely figure out the benefit of that data, and it'll directly benefit the market. So, I don't know, I'm kind of less concerned. It would be great to have an understanding of what the ultimate purposes are, but I think it's almost a creation mechanism. You put it out there and people will find something to do with it and generate from it. That's one comment. On regulations, I'm hoping what Ed meant was no bad regulations or remove bad regulations, because it seems to me we ought to have some. I'm thinking back to, you know, something minor like the mortgage meltdown. With no regulation, it's the Wild West. With some smart regulation, you can manage things. With over-regulation, you stymie innovation in the market. So I was just going to ask Ed, is it no regulation or is it removing the bad stuff?
No, absolutely. I mean, you can't create a digital single market without regulation. But, you know, could we just adapt, you know, for every new regulation, we take five away or something like that? Could we do a deal like that? Or maybe one for two? Some sort of a deal?
Daniele, be very popular.
Yeah, I wanted also to make just a small remark on the open data and the traceability of the use of open data, because you may try to identify users, because you can download, for example, only if you log in, even if it's for free, which is also already a sort of maybe small obstacle sometimes, but in any case, you never know what is the use of those data. You know who downloads the data, but then maybe sometimes they just stay on hard disk, sometimes they are reused and you don't see how they are reused. So I think it's very important, even more than identification, the feedback. So the way in which you, in a way, create a link with the users of open data, also because, not necessarily only because you want to know what they do, but also because they need to tell you what they need. And the feedback should be a two-way mechanism. Users express their need for the open data, the improvement of quality or whatever. We have seen that it's not as simple as that. And the data provider, so the public administration who releases open data, know better who are their customers.
Yeah, I think that the comment from Ulla was exactly to establish a bilateral information flow in which you have the feedback, but the feedback is also including request for. And for me, you don't necessarily need to know what they are doing with the data, but they have to report about what they need to be done on the data to support their businesses. So, frankly speaking, if I know that there are thousands of people that are using my data, as a data provider, I can go to my minister and say, look, I'm supporting more than 1,000 users, or I'm supporting a market, and the user, I have the impression that they need to do something on the data, so I need some additional money to improve the quality, or I can go directly to the user to ask to have a kind of sharing of resources to improve the quality. So it will be different case by case. But I think that this kind of structural dialogue is not existing and in most of our administrations. And so it should be something that we have to think about. At the moment, we are still working on the old model of the model of the digital economy. If I take the example of Ordnance Survey, they have an annual meeting with their main users. They discuss about improvement. Today we are in an environment which, by providing the information to the internet, we have much more users, and this model is not anymore the right one. I think that we have now to start. Which one is the first? Please.
Hi, Kira Billard. I'm going to ask a question to you first of all, but mainly because I agree very strongly with two of the things you said in your presentation. One is we need to change the way we engage with users of data it's not just about ISO metadata, throw it out and everything will happen. There needs to be a different type of engagement mechanism so people can get the value from the data. Secondly, is the thing you raised about this grey area that exists between what is a wholly public service to which is a public service that's delivered by the private sector. And I think over the next 10 years, that's kind of where the disruption is going to come. You're going to kind of see the Uber, the Airbnb happening in the way that public services are produced. Public services see, might just provide the data, but then other people will provide the engagement with the citizens. And that's going to be a big change for a lot of people. My comment really comes back to this whole DSM agreement. I can say this from an organization that delivers remaps and licenses data, including from the Danish government, to produce integrated mapping products. We have our biggest cost element is actually in managing the regulations that every single part of that organization wants. Everyone wants the integrated product. We have to report back to all our suppliers what percentage in every 1 degree square of product contains something from a source organization. So we may have a product that might contain 1% of Danish data. We have to report that back to the Danish government. We have to pay, I think it's 15,000 kroner a year just for actually having that in our product, even though the cost of doing it doesn't actually match the volume of Danish data we sell. But we didn't have that, we'd have big gaps in the pan-European government. It's not, they are, Norway has a different set of rules, yeah. Germany has a different set of rules. What it means is we have to pass that cost on to customers who then see it, well, this is all public data. Why are we having to pay for this product? So the value they're getting is not in the polymerization that we provided, but in the cost that we have in serving the administrative layer we have to put for that. So that's my vote for having the DSM.
Maybe Margarita, you want to say something about the this aspect of legal interoperability, not only the technical one, or
yes, well, I was precisely thinking before your intervention and whether what is mentioned of the better regulation, no regulation, etc. But in fact, what we are thinking in the Digital Single Market Initiative is that the companies are faced with 28 regulations, yeah. And the purpose is that they face less one. They deal one. Well, that's perhaps too idealistic, but it comes exactly to what you are saying. You are faced with this, and then this, and then this, and
if
this.
If you look at the global market, I can get data from NOAA easily. Try to get data from the NGA, it's like completely different. And people think the US is a much more open market. It's not always the same. So it's a global problem, not just.
Just to say, it's not 28, it's 28 times the number of regions, times the number of administrations.
Yeah. Much more. Then I think that the second, Mark.
Yeah, thank you. So I'm a French civil servant, so you know in France we love regulations. And we begin to understand what could be a private society useful for. I believe that French citizens prefer Google as a public service instead of INSPIRE or Acquire, because for everybody Google is useful, and for too many people INSPIRE is useful. That one thing is we are building, as Ulla showed, we are building things for centuries. The French cadaster is 2 centuries old, we are making it new this year. And in 200 centuries, we hope that we still have a cadastre in Europe and so on. So the time is not the same, and we have to take the time to protect the future of our civilization. And the second thing is, we don't build at the beginning Europe for single market, digital or not. We are building Europe for community against war. And beside economics, we have history in Europe, and the strong history of Europe is to be able to talk together, to build things together. And interoperability is just one tool, and regulation, for example, we're talking about here. It's just a tool to reach a place where we could live together, and even not as four children or grandchildren. So the difference between what you can see in North America, for example, or in other places. Here, we are strongly political people in Europe, I believe, not in France. And what we have to do is to dismantle regulation, because obviously we have bad regulation. I don't know if we will talk about open data in 10 years, because open data is a way to take data to be against administration, to force administration to you, to be smarter to you. And it's heavy on Goliath, in a way. And so I think what we have to do together is to be smarter, to be more agile, and to be focused on the citizens, on political needs, on more or less private societies, on government, I hope, we are trying to do that.
There was another thing yet.
Yes. Last year, this year, I heard a lot about the users, what data they want, what software they want. But I believe there is another level that the users, it's more important to see what they really want. And this level is the infrastructure. The infrastructure itself. If it's user friendly or not, because part of the complexity of the infrastructure comes to the software, comes to the data, and comes to the user. So, my question is how do they feel, do they see, for example, are ready to sacrifice complexity, for example, in the infrastructure level for the good of the user? What sacrifices can they do? I mean, the government and the public sector, in order to get the user even to the infrastructure level, not just to the application of the data.
I think that your comment is very appropriate. We have a similar discussion in one of the INSPIRE meeting, in the INSPIRE policy group meeting, when we were discussing about one of the obstacles today is that, okay, INSPIRE start to provide the data, but if I want to develop an application, I have to connect directly to the infrastructure. So how we can simplify the use, etc. It was a very raised point from some of the INSPIRE representative. And we realized that effectively it's something that we didn't touch so far. And it's requiring, as you mentioned, a simplification about the access. So we were starting discussing about developing API to ensure that service provider could develop the application. So it's something that is coming in our pipeline. Clearly, we have to deal with all the things, but it is a very good point. In particular, I see that it's becoming a very important point for the digital single market, because it's the only way to support application development. And we believe that in the future, it's not responsibility of the European Commission to deal directly with the user, but it's the private sector that have to develop application tailored to the different markets. And we need to simplify the way in which they can develop application. This is something that I think that is shared between all the INSPIRE community. But thank you to remind us. Francesco?
I just would like to underline that the European Union location framework, that now there was a workshop that we parallel to this one, and if we had another workshop on Friday, I know Friday is not my time to go through that, but at the end, it's not the week. But we are using our pilots, you know, the European Union location framework is trying to extend this by approach to infrastructure in another domain. We are tackling two of the higher that Mar underlined that buildings and the building try to reduce the CO2 emissions of buildings, so try to have an inventory of these buildings in Europe. and which way in 2020 we can try to align INSPIRE and the Energy Performance of Building Directive, Energy Efficiency Directive, preventative measure that in Europe more than 60,000 mayors have signed. As of this morning, we have seen a mayor doesn't even know how many buildings he has in his own city. And this is a main issue. So, what would be, you can imagine in the future, if you have an open platform where you know which buildings at building level, municipal level, regional level, European level, the emission of your buildings, and in which way is this data available, how you can utilize this gas, electricity. A small medium enterprise can use this data and the market that we can have in the future. Another example was Ulla and Ed said before about the relation between the dialogue between public data, public governance, and the private sector. For example, intelligent transport system. We're trying to extend INSPIRE in this domain. Different attributes, we have to extend the attributes, but what happens today? For example, in your car, you have your navigator. And how, when do you know if in the street you have static road data? For example, 60 is the limit, you can change to 80 kilometers per hour, 2 miles per hour. Or even worse, vice versa. You should know in real time, not in 6 months' time. If you have a one-way street and dynamically change to two-way street because there is an event, you should know. How many times you go on Saturday in this street is closed because every week there is a market? You don't know. So you can imagine if you know that this data in real time, how much time you save.
Wonder how we managed to live before the digital.
A lot of other things. You know, and also, for example, there are some other times when
life was one big adventure.
The reason is today that TomTom and Nokia, which are private companies, they don't get real-time information, quasi real-time information, but maybe gadgets and all the topics. The result is that Teachable asks us which way we can avoid that these private companies have to have different agreements with different member states, regional level, you could say, at the city level, because there are a so scattered situation, and at least if you INSPIRE, you can have 5-6 contracts, it's already a big improvement. And I think this is also what we face with Street View. And what happens today is that there is no motivation for those authorities to give this data to private companies, because they don't receive anything back. So they don't understand this dialogue is not. So there is a lot of potential, I think,
in Europe to
reduce the market.
This example is basically an additional example of the future public-private partnership in which public authorities are providing to the private sector the data that is needed to develop a specific application and to cover a specific market. But this is a good example when we see the difficulties today to develop this kind of application, because as mentioned, the private sector is going very fast. When they see a window opportunity for a new market, they have to cover before another company or competitors is covering. And the public sector is not going at the same speed. So there is an issue that is a cultural change also in the public authority to be a fast responder, and the digital single market will be certainly be a push to innovate. And I don't know if in the government action plan this will be considered or not, but in a way, if we want really that e-government services are supporting businesses, there is something to be done in both sides. We are now going to close to the end. There is one aspect that has not been covered that has been mentioned about capacity building, creation of digital skills. It's also important because in some countries the obstacle is the lack of technical expertise or the lack of capacity to do services. from one side, you can simplify the use of existing infrastructure, but it's not enough. We need also to invest. Before concluding, I will ask the six panelists to tell in 1 minute what is the more important things to be done for the digital single market as far concerned the geospatial sector. And I will start with Ulla. 1 minute.
Yes, thank you. Now I got, it's really cold sitting here. Really, really cold. Thank you, Hugo. There's a lot of things that need to be done. But I will get back to your question, Margaret. I think the gray zone between what is public and what is private is essential to discuss. Maybe not solve, but absolutely. Where does public stop and where does private start?
Thank you.
Okay, I'd go for two things. I think the capacity building that you mentioned is very important. There's a clear skill shortage in Europe, both in a technical sense, but also understanding access to capital and understanding how to build businesses quickly. And the other thing is, and I think we'll probably all mention it to a greater or lesser extent, smart regulation. Absolutely, I'm not against regulation, but please, any regulation that we bring in meets the intended consequences, doesn't have unintended consequences, and you know, little regulation is better than more regulation.
Thank you. Hugo.
I'm totally with Ed. Regulation, align regulation, do it smarter. I can tell you it's not going to be easy because you step in into a consensus building process with a white stallion and you come out in the end with a camel. Inspire is not a pineapple, it's a camel. So I think that's the most important thing, that we are very clear and avoid all these kind of strange sentences like with reasonable return on this and with that. No clear cut. Everybody agreeing, but let's not go down to too many consensus.
Thank you. Hugo, Margarita?
So the first, for the first question, for me it is obvious that the biggest important thing from the geospatial for the digital single market is the cross-sector dimension, interoperability of geospatial. Now, on the regulation, I would nevertheless like to stress that there has been some discussions inside the Commission on this better regulation. And I think one big step forward that was achieved in this better regulation package is to integrate the digital check and ICT implications in the impact assessment of each legislative proposal. I think this is a big step forward because it was something that was often left forgotten. So this, I think it deserves being mentioned here since we are speaking about better regulation, no regulation, more regulation, whatever. This, I think it was a big step forward. Now we'll have to see.
That was for me, not for me.
Just to finish?
It was for me.
Okay. Of course, there is also in parallel what Hugo mentioned, that each legislation is a process of big discussions between the different legislative actors in the European space, and then at the end of the day, we don't know what comes out of it. But I think, in any case, it is something that is, we try to improve, and this was real good to put this digital check in impact assessment, and we are very happy with that.
Thank you, Margarita. Mark.
I'll just, it often seems like this is something. A piece of food that's just too big to bite off and chew, right? Mm-hmm. They're very complex, but going back to your example, I would just argue that some quick wins up front would be good if you can isolate some real clear situations where the cultural differences are prohibiting commerce across national boundaries to pilot a solution or two or three with the assistance of government to generate agreements for the purposes of determining the outcome. If we agree to a common approach, what is that outcome? What does it look like? How does it benefit all of the players? And if there's goodness there, then that becomes a stimulation for other agreements. So I would really encourage piloting. We've had similar experiences, you know, Alessandro, in the standards community when there's big disagreement, is to actually get your hands dirty and try things. I would highly suggest that, because this seems to be so big, it's hard to figure out where you start working. But if you have clear examples that are heartstring issues for industry and users, I think we start there and pilot.
Thank you. Interesting. Daniele.
Yes. So on the simplification that we are masters in complexifying things, well, I have to say here, I think I reminded in the presentation, at least on paper, that DSM has a quite wise approach in, first of all, deciding that most of the legislation which could be needed is plugged in into already existing directives which are under revision. And for what is not yet available now, there is a plan which starts for making studies and then impact assessments and then different options. One of them, but not necessarily that one, could be a new legislation. So at least from the beginning, there is an approach which says we are not going as we do several times. We need a directive and nothing else. And maybe one thing which came out also this morning on the fact that, and I think in terms of which public administrations are providing input and generate special information, compared to years ago, now the panorama is much more diversified. There are regional authorities, domain-related authorities, and maybe this once-only principle should also be applied within countries, to avoid that data are collected more than once. I mean, implementing to what is the INSPIRE principle, which is that data should be shared and then they should be exchanged and avoid to collect them more than once. This would already help before the DSM is even out.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniele. Just before closing the session, I would like to inform that you now that this session has been recorded.
Thank you.
So everything that you said is there in that video, and it will be also an opportunity for the people that were sitting in several parallel sessions, because you know, I have so many parallel sessions, to have a look to what has been discussed today. I think that this session was very successful thanks to the excellent speaker that were covering all the aspects. For me, it's much more clear now what is the digital single market, and it's also more clear where are the areas that require to be addressed or require more attention. It will be my intention to try to write a short report about what has been discussed in the session, to share with all the speakers in order then to publish. That's just the result of the conference, and could be of inspiration for our colleague working on the digital single market that can see from our perspective, we are representing in any case a significant segment of the GDP as a geospatial community. It could be of interest of Dean to see which are our recommendations and our suggestions, and then they can ignore or can they take into consideration will be up to Dean. I will contact you after the conference. We start making a first draft, and then we have to work together, and maybe we publish on geospatial media, maybe the results of this. So I will ask now to really to applaud all the speakers for...